God bless you and welcome to the Sanctuary Christian Center. This is Pastor Marco Sims. So glad to have you here with me again, another day of Bible study. We are in 1 Corinthians, the 5th chapter. We've talked about thus far the immorality that's going on in Corinthians, and the main objectives in the first four chapters was really highlighting the division in the church. How some think themselves greater than others, and we have some pastors and leaders that feel that way, or we have people that feel that way that are from various denominations, because you don't serve that under that leadership, or under that regime, or under that dogma, religious dogma. They feel that everything is wrong in your life. So we need to be continuously praying and believing God for the right word. The word that would penetrate the hearts of people, that will convert them so that we could have a walk with God and walk in the divine calling that he has set for our lives. So let's pray, and we're going to go right into chapter 5. So if you don't have your Bibles, pull out your Bibles now, get your pen and paper. This is study time, and I pray that I don't move too fast for you, that you're not able to capture what I am stating at the moment as well, but you have the opportunity to play this back as well. Let's go into prayer. Gracious Father, we honor you. We thank you for another day. Be with us, Lord, as we teach your word. God, when I read the word, you taught, my Lord, so that the people, your people, the disciples, would be able to translate what you said. And that's the word that's penned for us today. Help us to pin it on our hearts, God, that we follow the instructions of God's word, my Lord. We feel your presence and your anointing that abides within us, that helps us to walk this righteous walk. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Just let me summarize a little bit of this chapter. As I turn away a little bit, I'm looking at my notes as well here. So allow me to do that as well. The problems I talked about in Corinth was the immorality that was going on in that area, but Paul highlighted some things there. And what was his main point that he was highlighting is that there was immorality amongst the people, his chosen people that were there. And he began to say, but look at the Gentiles that had not been selected as God's chosen are choosing a righteous walk. My Lord, how can that be? And that I've come, sat with you, supped with you, penned the letter to you to give you divine instructions. And my Lord, those just got on board and began to embrace the word of God. They're walking righteous walks. That's what he's saying. And then you, instead of mourning for your actions, you are puffed up about it. You know, when you catch somebody in the wrong, when they've done wrong, especially your child, I get a witness here. Sometimes I have a teenage son, and he gets puffed up when I catch him and he's wrong. And so instead of me arguing or raising my voice any longer, I begin to laugh at the folly and begin to look at the devices of the enemy. The enemy keeps us trapped in the same area all the time. And so we have to change our ways, because the devil's actions and what he does is consistent. He comes the same way to attack us in the same manner, until we sit back and we take and embrace that and say, devil, your stuff ain't working. So that's where we have to be at today. Okay, so that's what he's saying. So he said, I want to clarify this writing that I'm giving you too in this epistle. So I'll be precise and I'll be very clear about this, what's going on here. And so that's what he's doing. I'm delivering instructions. And he began to say, Paul then instructs them to deliver such a one to Satan, those whose hearts are not right, that are in the church, he's saying, deliver them to Satan. And when you think about that, we talk about that a little leaven can mess up the whole lump. Oh, then that's in this passage as well. So let's go to the word of God. I'm going to read for you the first two verses, and I'm reading out of the, I believe this is the Common English Bible, CEB. And this is the word of God. Everyone has heard that there is sexual immorality among you. There's a type of immorality that isn't even heard of among the Gentiles. See the difference? A man is having sex with his father's wife. And you're proud of yourselves instead of being so upset that one who did this thing is expelled from your community. So instead of expelling that person from the community or speaking to them about a wrong, they upheld them. Now, why is this so? Because I wouldn't want to expel you if that's the same lifestyle that I'm living. And so what I began to think about, that many of us as Christians are living on the cusp, right on the edge. And the Bible does speak about being hot or cold. And so what he's saying, how can I tell you not to do that? And I'm doing that. So we got to be careful that we're walking the walk and we're living the life that we're talking and preaching about, especially us as preachers. No, I want to put this out there again. We're not perfect, but we're striving for perfection. Let's be honest. If you got a thorn, I've got a thorn. Let's take it to the Lord and let's pray for deliverance. But if you're not praying for it and you're not acknowledging it, then you don't want any help. Then we continue doing the same things that we're doing. And I believe that's what's blocking us from the glory of the Lord, actually filling the place. And so often we think that that's God's glory, as when we say, oh, praise him, church. And we want the highlight of the service at the conclusion of the ministering of God's word to shout the people. You're not getting your deliverance like that if you're not walking in the light. We are still struggling. After the shout is over, after the dance is over, the struggle still remains. Now, help me, church. What do we do with that? My Lord, there's a way for us to get deliverance. And we've got to acknowledge it and give attention to it. So he says that. And Leviticus talks about that. In Leviticus 18 and 80 says, the nakedness of thy father's wife shall not uncover it. Is thy father's nakedness? And then it goes over in Deuteronomy 22 and 30 says, a man shall not take his father's wife, nor discover his father's skirt. Cursed be he that lie with his father's wife. That is 27 and 20 from Deuteronomy. And so that's what he's talking about in this case, that should be expelled from the community. There's a word, a Greek word called porneia. Porneia talks about sexual immorality, but it talks about sexual immorality in conjunction with homosexuality, immoral sex, and it also gave highlight to what was happening in Corinth, a prostitution that was dominant in the area. And so because the lifestyle of the Corinthians were, they were accustomed to sexual immorality, and then they said, now I'm taking on Jesus Christ. We can't just say I'm taking on Jesus Christ. We have to wear it, my Lord, that the world can see it. It has to be demonstrated in our walk, in our talk, in our character, hot or cold. There's no in between in God at all. So that's what was happening to this area here. Sexual immorality was accepted fact for the common person in that Greek culture. And because they were so accustomed to it, it was inbred within their custom with the gods that they served. They saw no wrong with it. So every now and then we need to help a brother or a sister. The word says, ye which are overtaken with a fault, restore such a one. If your brother is overtaken with a fault, help me, God. If your brother is overtaken with a fault, restore such a one. Now, how do we restore them? We don't restore them by getting on the phone and talking about them and placing judgment on them. We restore them in love. We greet them. We have conversation with them. And he who wins souls is wise. That's the same process, not for a person that's just out in the street that's secular. We want to keep that soul in Jesus. So there's some work that has to be done in with compassion. We've got to be compassionate about what we're doing so that we can win that soul over. That is so important for us. Let's recognize that. And so you want to have conversation with the other individual and not to judge them at all. He without sin, let him cast the first stone. So we want to be careful that porneia. So it talks about sexual immoralities in that area. Let us go through and read verses 3-5. And this is the CEB Bible. Though I'm absent physically, I'm present in the spirit, and I've already judged the man who did this as if I were present. Now, when I thought about that, Paul is actually saying that he did judge that man. And then we will say, what right did Paul have to judge that man at all? And generically speaking, when I say man, what right did he have? And so when I thought about that in a spiritual realm, God sits and knows all, omniscient, omnipresent, with us at all time. He sees and knows all. There's no hiding place for us in Jesus at all. So we might as well admit it and be honest about it. I say today, if we're honest, you can get help. If we're honest, we can get help, my Lord Jesus. But if you're not, you're living in the shadows of your own life. And that's where the pain comes in, when we live in the shadows of our own life without being honest about our character and our walk. We have flaws. As Christians, we have flaws. Let's just be honest about it. There's a thorn in many of our sides. Pastors, preachers, teachers, evangelists. Come on, church. Let's be real about it. But we've got to go to the throne of grace. And Paul says, I die daily. So in order to get the help that we need, we've got to die daily. We've got to get to the altar so that we can get the help that we need. So Paul is saying, I'm not with you physically, but I'm there in the spirit realm with you. When you meet together in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I'll be present in the spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus down on the inside of me. His power resonates within the environment, and the same Jesus that's in me is the same Jesus that's in you. At least it should be. At that time, we need to hand this man over to Satan to destroy his human weakness so that his spirit might be saved on the day of the Lord. Now, what is he saying? Turn this man over to Satan. And that's not literally just kicking him out of the church. If you find someone that's with you or that has accompanied you or call themselves friend and don't want to live up to the word of God, we have to let that go, my Lord Jesus. And after you've preached and taught and met with them enough, that's not your function. That's not your task any longer. My Lord, we give them up to Jesus. That's what we have to do so that that soul is not lost. We don't just totally kick them out. We've got to be praying for them. We've got to be strategic in this walk. And so while I was waiting on my sister to get saved, I didn't throw salvation up in her face all the time, but I prayed like never before. And I waited on God. And so what's so important for us to understand is the wait time for us may not happen when you want it to happen. But I tell you, we've got to wait on God like never before. That's what he is saying. The word of God says to us over in Matthew, the 7th chapter, it says, judge not, let you be judged, lest you be judged. That's what it's really saying, lest you be judged. So we shouldn't be doing that. But then God also says to us as a people, we're not perfect, and Paul was not perfect either. But what he is saying, there are standards that we have to live up to. And so what we have to do, we've got to be honest about our conduct. Therefore, we can help somebody else. If I'm wallowing in fornication, if I'm lying and cheating and stealing all the time, why do I want to put my mouth on somebody else that's doing that? And so this is very precious for us as parents as well. And I had to learn this. I cannot tell my child to do something that I'm doing. How do I tell my child, don't drink that alcohol? How do I tell my child that smoking is bad for you while I'm taking the puff off that cigarette? How do I do that? Definitely. And we know everything God made was good and is good. But how we use it, we abuse it. Let's be honest with that. And so that's enough that I can say on that for us to be able to hear. If you've got wisdom, I want you to hear what I'm saying, people of God. We can't keep telling somebody else to do something and we're doing it. You've got to be very particular about where you're worshiping at. I say this to people all the time. There's a spirit that looms over the presence of wherever you're residing at, and that would be the spirit of the Lord or the enemy that hovers over them, especially if it's over that presiding individual, that leader of the house. If homosexuality is within that individual and you have no knowledge of it, you're wondering what's happening in the church around you in the environment. And I speak from experience, from worshiping in places that I had no knowledge of. And so you're saying, how can I get a grip on myself? What's happening here? And so that transference, that spirit of immorality runs rampant around the church. Or you've got a pastor that's committing fornication all the time and you're saying, I want to save myself. I want to make sure that I'm saved and I want to keep myself. And so when I got wind of where I was worshiping at, that the leadership was struggling, and I'm already struggling, my God, I found myself leaving to go someplace where I knew my Lord Jesus, that leader, my Lord, was leading under the auspices of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, where I saw men worshiping, coming to the prayer hour. And we need to compel men to come to the prayer hour. Women should not beat us to the prayer hour. If we say that we're the head and not the tail, then we ought to act like it. We ought to be present during the prayer hour, on the prayer lines, leading prayer. My God, Jesus, that's an attack of the enemy. And so as a church, we need to be praying like never before, that myth is dead, that season of men not praying is dead in Jesus' name. We have to attack the enemy strategically and be specific about our prayers. And so that's what's happening here at this time. Paul is saying, I can place judgment on that individual that's walking with me, not per se as judging them, but I need to have conversation with them. And I think that's where we lack at in the church. When there is division, and it happens in many of our churches, the prejudice, the separatism, my God, Jesus, the racism in the church, it's very dominant and prevalent in America today. So let's call out that enemy right now. And so we need to address it, my Lord. And if we don't address it, what it does, it balloons, it grows, it festers, it gets out of control. The man or woman of God that's the leader of the house should be addressing those things in private settings with those individuals. You don't stand up from your pulpit and use your pulpit as a target base to hit the individuals and to talk about those subject matters and those individuals specifically from the pulpit. That's not what it's designed for. It's designed to preach the word of God. So we've got to be careful that we don't abuse this authority that we have in Jesus' name, because it has been abused before. Let us go on to do this, to read this word. And he says, your bragging isn't good. Don't you know that a tiny grain of yeast makes a whole batch of dough rise? Clean out the old yeast so you can be a new batch of dough. Given that you're supposed to be unleavened bread, Christ our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. So let's celebrate the yeast with the unleavened bread, my Lord, of honesty and truth, not with old yeast or with the yeast of evil and wickedness. Not at all. We don't want to revert back to the old ways. Okay, so let me read this in the King James Version. This is how we know it. Your glory is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened, for even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to accompany with fornicators. You got to watch who you're breaking bread with. And that's a true manner. How can two walk together except they agree? That's powerful within itself. But what he's talking about, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. And so it will rise when you're feeding a situation, when you're talking about somebody else, when you're placing judgment on them. That's not a small lump. It just gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and eventually it gets out of control. But you know what? Well, ask me what, church? We've added to it because we add to the conversation instead of taking from the conversation. So we've got to be very careful of what we're doing and how we're doing things. Very, very careful about situations. And so that's very important for us to make note of. He says, purge out therefore the old leaven. What happened? Let's talk a little bit about Passover. Passover itself was the Jews being freed from slavery and Exodus. My God, we know that the Passover represented the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. So we've got to be careful to make note of that so that we can understand what's really happening. And within the Passover time, they celebrated for 7 or 8 days. They commemorated the Feast of Unleavened Bread. They actually didn't put any yeast in their bread at all, which represented the time when they just packed up their bags and they left Egypt and they had the bread that was unleavened. But what was so important about that was that during that feasting time, they would do what was called vetching. Vetching, they were mourning as they were setting the table, as they were mourning and groaning over where they had come from, and the preparation of preparing the seder, the setter, the food that they were about to partake of at the conclusion of the whole matter of that celebration is the setter. And so they were celebrating, but they were mourning. So at the top of this chapter, Paul said to the Jews at that time, you don't even mourn in the Corinthian family. You're not even mourning. You should be able to understand what took place during the Passover, that they mourned as they were preparing for the Passover. You don't even mourn for your faults and your sins at all. You just stay right in your sins. My God, Jesus. And what has God done to those that walk. God says to us, he says in Romans 1 and 28, he says, furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a deprived mind so that they do what ought not to be done. Gave them a reprobate spirit. So he wasn't so much as kicking them out. That was the state of mind that they were already in. You've got to want to be saved. My God, this isn't a hard walk for us to walk in at all. You've just got to surrender your will. That's the sacrifice that we bring to the table. We offer up a sacrifice unto Jesus. My Lord, this body, this temple, this mind, this will, we offer it up to Jesus with simplicity. And so that's what was happening during the Passover. And the setter was the time, and they were setting the table where they had the bitter herbs. They had the egg that represented the birth. The bitter herbs represented them actually coming out of bitterness. My Lord, they had a paste that they put together with fruit and nuts that they put together as well. That represented the mortar that they had to use to build the bricks there. Then they had the shank bone from the actual lamb, which represented the Passover lamb, Jesus Christ himself. Then they had green leaves on the plate, on the setter as well. And those green leaves represented hope and redemption. My Lord Jesus, they were mourning as they were preparing the setter. My Lord Jesus, have you not just sit and in your worship time, not just got so emotional, but have you just sit and cried in the presence of Jesus and began to say, God, the sacrifice that you made for me, I'm just so grateful. God, hallelujah, how I bless you, with tears just pouring down my face that I began to bless him. Oh God, groaning in the Holy Ghost because my soul is so satisfied in Jesus, and I'm so excited about what God has done. I'm so excited about what God continues to do. Oh, yes. So we need to understand the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread and what it meant. And so they said, therefore, let us keep the feast with old leaven, never with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. That we don't want to go back to where we've come from. We're moving forward in Jesus' name. So he said, I'm writing this to tell you that you've got to watch the company that you're keeping. We've got to tell us that in the church as well, that we don't get caught up. Because a lot of times we get caught up. And so let's watch that. Let's pay attention and let's ask the Lord to bless us with wisdom. The last verses 9 through 13. This is the word of God for the people of God. I wrote to you in my earlier letter not to associate with sexual immoral people. I'm letting you know that because you'll get caught up because you may be weak. That's what I'm telling you. But I wasn't talking about sexual immoral people in the outside world by any means, or the greedy or the swindlers or people who worship false gods. Otherwise, you would have to leave the world entirely. I'm not saying that you can't socialize with them outside in the world like that. You're socializing with an intent. You are intentional. Yes, that my light will shine brightly. That I would be the shining beacon in the room amongst the people. Oh, and I'm not doing this all the time, but my light is shining so bright that I'm drawing them to me. I'm drawing them that they may ask me questions, not to place judgment on me. But then Paul comes over and says, he says, but now I'm writing to you not to associate with anyone who calls themselves brother or sisters. Because see, there is a lot of false relationships in the church. Who is sexually immoral, greedy, someone who worships false gods, an abusive person, a drunk, or a swindler. Don't even eat with anyone like this. What do I care about judging outsiders? Isn't it your job to judge insiders? God will judge the outsiders, expel the evil one from among you. And so what he's saying, we've got to be particular even about what's in the house. How many of us know that Satan is in, it comes to church on Sunday? Satan dresses up on Sunday and comes to church with the big hat on, with the sharpest suit on, with the red bottom shoes on. My God, Jesus. And then he comes in jeans as well. It doesn't matter. It's what's on the inside of him. My Lord, so don't be tricked by the devices of the enemy. In olden days, our ancestors, mothers, and fathers had it. They had a word, and the word would be a cliche. And my mother would say, my God, birds of a feather flock together. So if you're with the common folk that are doing those things, that are thieving, lying, cheating, killing, and stealing, you will become one of those. If you're hanging out with the drunkard, eventually you're going to start drinking the liquor. Yes, you will. Or ask me, I can give you a testimony. If you're hanging out with everybody that's smoking and smoking the dope, my Lord, you'll start smoking the dope too. Don't tell me what you won't do, because that's what the enemy has snuck in on your weaknesses. Because you've ministered it, you said it out in the atmosphere. I won't do this. I won't do that. And that's the very thing that he put in front of you to help you to associate with those types of people. The very thing you said you wouldn't do. My God, you got to be strong with the presence of God inside of you. You can't do this by yourself, church. Church, church, church. Stop trying to do this by yourself. My God, we got to do this with the power of the Holy Ghost down within us. When Jesus left, hallelujah, he said, I am leaving you with power. We've got to understand the power of God that's down on the inside of us. And I say to the church at large, the church of God, we are the people of God. It's time to tap in. No more excuses, church, my God. Hang the excuses up, my God. No more fears in Jesus' name. It's time to walk in the power of God. No more doubt. We eradicate doubt in the name of Jesus. We're walking in the power and the strength and the might of the Holy Ghost. Not in my power, but in the power of Jesus. Oh, I come to encourage you in Jesus. So Paul was saying, you've got to guard what God has given you. And so we don't do that. We take this lightly. My God, if you had a 5 or 6 carat diamond on your ring, ladies, my God, or if you had a precious ruby and you wore it every single day, you'd get it insured. You'd have the highest amount of insurance on it as possible. Why would we not insure the Holy Spirit that's down on the inside of us? Woo, Jesus. Now, how do I do that? Because I've got to guard that, my God, because it's so precious to me. It's a lifetime warranty. It's the policy that was already signed. I didn't sign the policy. Jesus signed the policy and sealed it with his blood. My God, Jesus, you didn't do it. I didn't do it. Jesus did it. Hallelujah. So it's a lifetime guarantee that he has offered the church. That if you just walk in the light, if you would just remain and be the children of God that I've called you to be, if you would serve me like I've compelled you to do because I made you, that you would give me glory and honor, if you would acknowledge the presence of my power down on the inside of you. Oh, God, you can do the miraculous. Oh, church, my God. God wants to do the miraculous through the children of God. Hallelujah. So Paul is preaching to the church. Don't live beneath your privileges any longer. So I say to us as a church, don't live beneath your privileges any longer. My God, come out from amongst them. That's what Paul was saying. Come out from amongst that immorality. And you know what's going on in your life. I didn't come here to judge you and to talk about what's going on in your life. God has just commissioned me to preach the word, and the glory of the Lord will fill the place, and the glory of the Lord will save the church, and the glory of the Lord will heal the brokenhearted, my God, and the glory of the Lord will redeem. Let the redeemed of the church say so. Anybody out there redeemed, hallelujah, let the redeemed of the church say so. Woo! Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Know your place in God. And it's time to get in your place in God. Because God's got a position designated just for you. I pray that you were encouraged. And be encouraged as we continue to teach out of 1 Corinthians. We'll be in chapter 6 next week. Be encouraged. Gracious Father, we honor you. We bless you for your word. I pray that this word has permeated the hearts of the hearers, that it would transform our lives. Help us, God, to step up to the calling that you've placed on our lives, understanding that we are servants of the Most High God. My Lord, bless us in our walk, our talk, our character, that we would exemplify you the more. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen. Be encouraged. We're here on Facebook Live every Thursday at 6 p.m. Eastern time every Thursday, and also on our prayer line. We pray on the prayer line Monday through Friday. And the prayer line number is 641-715-3670 with a participant code of 688800#. Be encouraged, everybody. I pray that you are encouraged in Jesus' name. God bless you all.